All right, ladies and gentlemen, if I could have your attention, thank you all so much for showing up today for the Health and Human Services. All right, I'll start that again. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for showing up to the Health and Human Services Committee in the Senate. We appreciate y'all being here. I'm a guy that kind of likes to start on time and keep things rolling, so I appreciate your consideration with that. For those people that are here about possible exec this afternoon, we will not be execing anything today. So if anyone's here specifically for exec session, you are free to go. But next week, we will have a very full exec session. So at the start of the day, we'd like to open up House Bill 271 and ask the prime sponsor, because I could have sworn I saw her there. Representative, how are you? Thank you so much for coming in today. Truly appreciate it.
Thank you for hearing my testimony.
And we'd love to hear you introduce your bill.
Maybe I'll be less nervous than the last time you saw me.
All right, so everyone take a deep breath. And exhale. Okay. This is the Senate. We have fun. Not causing any specific dispersions on what's happening in the House. But here, enjoy yourself.
Well, I'm here to ask your support of HB 271, which is a bill to increase access to the life-saving medication, Narcan. Narcan is just a popular name for it. The name of the actual medication is naloxone. So what is Narcan? Narcan is a pure opioid antagonist. That's it. It shuts off the opioid receptors in the body so that the drugs don't have an effect for a period of time. So this means that people stop being high and also stop dying. 30 years ago, when Narcan first hit the market, it was being administered in really big doses, and the result was that in addicted people, so this doesn't apply to people in accidental opioid overdose situations, in addicted people, they were slammed into withdrawals pretty violently, and side effects included vomiting and seizures. But over the last 30 years, the pharmaceutical manufacturers have gotten the drug to the point that it's extremely safe to administer, and it's administered almost constantly in ERs across the country. They determined that if you give Narcan in a very low dose, you still have the life-saving effect that you're looking for, and you don't have the side effects anymore, not even in the addicted people. So this has evolved to the level that it's probably even safer than an EpiPen to give someone to have on hand. It's harmless, it can't be abused, you can't get high off of it. In fact, it makes you the opposite of high. It makes you very, very sober and very much alive. So my bill does three things. First, it would give immunity from civil suit to any doctors that prescribe it, any people that administer it, and any organizations that distribute it. Second, my bill would allow organizations to distribute it under standing order with a doctor. Third, my bill allows for third-party access, third-party prescriptions. So that means that if you have a child who has been abusing either an illicit drug or a prescription medication and you're concerned that they might overdose, you can go to your doctor, get a prescription for Narcan, even though your doctor knows that you're going to be using that medication on someone else that he hasn't evaluated or even met necessarily. And that particular point is really important to a lot of people that are sitting behind me, because they have either lost their children to overdose, or their children are currently using drugs, or they're in recovery. People that are in recovery are most at risk of overdose, because if they're in recovery and they're making progress, if they relapse, a lot of times people will use the same volume of drug that they previously used when they had a tolerance. And when their tolerance has gone down after a period of sobriety, if they relapse and use the drug again and use the same volume, then there's a lot of overdoses in those situations, and that's when a lot of people die. And it's a shame, because they're on their way, they're making progress. They have one slip up, and suddenly they're dead. So the reason that New Hampshire needs this is because obviously the EMTs are great. They're doing an excellent job. They're working really hard. They saved over 3,000 lives. They administered Narcan over 3,000 times just last year. But still, several hundred people died last year, so clearly something's amiss. And then the governor suggested a rule change that would allow police to carry Narcan and administer it, but the rule change is such that it would happen at the cost of each individual police department. So this means that the police would have to purchase the Narcan, be trained in how to administer it, get liability insurance for administering it, etc. And the chief of the Concord Police was quoted in the Concord Monitor as saying that he doesn't think that they'll be adopting that anytime soon. So this is complicated, and not every police department is going to pick it up. So we can skip right over all of that business and pass this bill, which has no fiscal note, doesn't cost us any taxpayer dollars at all, and allow people that are likely to witness an overdose to access Narcan to use in those situations. So frankly, the parents are the first responders. I can't imagine something more terrifying than the powerless feeling that someone must experience when they walk into a room and their child's unconscious and all they can do is call 911 and wait. Especially when from the onset of overdose to brain damage is a time lapse of about 4 to 6 minutes. So that's about how long it takes for the EMT to arrive. In good situations when there isn't snow blocking the roads like there was this winter. So it seems like pretty cut and dry to me. We're not spending any money. We're just gonna let people access the medication that they can use. It's safe to use. And it's also, let me clarify, it's a nasal spray. It's available as a nasal spray. You can get the type that you inject into the muscle, but the nasal spray is really easy to use. It's like Afrin and you're done. What else? So the governor's task force recommended extending access to Narcan to friends and family. That was number 2 on their list of recommendations. The Office of National Drug Control Policy called for expanding the availability of Narcan. And Senator Ayotte and Congressman Ginta both put in legislation this year, the Opioid Overdose Reduction Act of 2015. But their bill only takes the first step that my bill takes, which is that they want to grant immunity from civil suit to first responders who administer Narcan. My bill takes several more steps, enabling family members to have access to Narcan and use it, and also enabling organizations to distribute it. What else? So in Massachusetts, they've had some pretty interesting results. They passed a Narcan bill, a very large tax-funded Narcan bill that probably wouldn't pass in our state, in 2010. And they've saved hundreds of lives, and they currently have a 50% lower rate of death from overdose than our state has. So per capita in 2014, Massachusetts saw 13 overdose deaths per capita, and our state saw 23 overdose deaths per capita. I think that's fairly interesting, because it's a really different demographic down there too than we have up here. So clearly Massachusetts is doing something right if half as many people are dying from overdose in their state as here. Similar legislation has already been passed in 32 other states, and New Hampshire is the last in New England. And I'll also note that this benefits no particular corporation. The patent for naloxone has expired. Anyone can manufacture a generic form of it, so that's great. We're not helping anyone in particular. And I'll also point out that Narcan has interesting uses other than to revive someone from an opiate-induced overdose. For example, it can be used as an antidote for overdose from clonidine, which is a medication that lowers blood pressure. So there's a whole variety of people that can benefit from having a prescription for Narcan, including elderly people that are apt to get confused about their medication, possibly overdose, who knows. So I'd like to see people, you know, if you have a prescription for an opiate, you get a prescription for Narcan with it. You can choose to fill the prescription if you want, but I want to see people going home to their wives and saying, look, honey, this is where I keep the Narcan. If you find me, if something's wrong, this is how you give it to me. Because we need to bridge the gap, those 5 minutes that you get until brain damage begins, we need to bridge the gap and be able to administer this medication before the EMTs get there. Also, let's see. Oh, so there's a study in Washington State. They passed this in, I believe, also in 2010, and they did a study afterward, and they found that people were less likely to engage in risky behavior or, you know, drug use in that particular community after they had been given access to Narcan and trained in how to use it. So in particular, people, when they were trained in how to administer Narcan, they became like that guy in the group, like go to that guy, he knows how to save lives. And everyone knew, like, this is who we can rely on if someone overdoses. So people had a higher opinion of the person that was trained to administer Narcan. And then the person who's trained to administer Narcan had a higher opinion of himself. And then they found that those people that had been trained to use to administer Narcan were less, were likely to use less and less drugs by volume as time went on because they were suddenly educated about how risky their behavior was and the potential consequences of their drug use. And in some cases, people actually exited that community altogether and moved on with their lives. So this has a lot of unexpected positive effects. And similarly, not having access to Narcan has a lot of unexpected negative effects. It's sort of a ripple effect. I talked to a nurse who works at Frisbee Hospital. She works in the intensive care unit. She was going to come testify today, but she wasn't able to. And she told me that on average in their intensive care unit, they have about two people on a regular cycle who are on life support for about 2 weeks at a time before their families finally come in. Plug. And they're on life support because they didn't get medical help in time. They have brain damage. It's irreversible. And they're basically just waiting to die. And those are people who died from heroin overdose specifically, from the brain damage relating to that. Those are people that, you know, a lot of them, according to the nurse, none of them have health insurance. It's all at the cost of the hospital and at the cost of the state. These are people who are, you know, creating a lot of medical expenses who otherwise wouldn't need them if they had had a $30 or $50 dose of Narcan at the time of the overdose. Oh, and as I said, it's a nasal spray. It only takes about 10 minutes to train someone to use it, so this isn't a big deal. And I think I rattled on about everything I possibly could think of.
Representative, thank you so much for your testimony.
Thank you.
You're open to some questions?
Yes, of course.
Representative Fuller.
Thank you very much. You did a great job. You put a lot of really useful information in front of us. I'm very appreciative of that. I wanted to ask you if you had heard that the cost of Narcan now has gone way up as a result of the fact that it suddenly has this extremely useful life. And do you know anything about that?
Thanks for your question. You're asking, do I know anything about the cost going up? The 32 states that have passed legislation like this have passed that legislation in just the last maybe 5 years. So it makes sense that demand is going up because finally people are able to access this medication. But as I said, the patent for naloxone is expired. That means anyone can manufacture it, and surely as demand goes up, so will supply, and the price will go down again. Basic economics.
Thank you. Just follow up. I'm just concerned that, you know, because now it's so necessary that we're seeing with this demand, that the pharmaceuticals are taking advantage of a product that then is going to cost our hospitals, cost our police, cost families, or whatever it is, an unreasonable price. So I just wanted to see if you had any thoughts about that.
Thanks. I don't have a proposed solution for that. I think that's maybe an issue for another piece of legislation. No matter what price they charge, people are still overdosing, and the need still exists. And I hope that wouldn't get in the way of passing this legislation, certainly not. Okay, thanks.
Thank you. Any other questions? Seeing none, as always, Representative, thank you so much for coming in.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we have a lot of people signed up to speak today. And for the record, this is the subtlety of the Senate. There's no one here opposed to the bill. So you can keep your remarks succinct. And if you hear someone else who has testified on something, you might not want to feel the need to repeat what they've already provided, because again, there is no one here opposed to the bill. And again, for those who have not been here, bless you. For those who have not been here before, it's typically customary that we let the elected officials go first before we ask the general public to weigh in, as a sign of respect for those who have been elected in here representing people. And with that, I'll start to my left, Representative LeBrun. You are signing in support and wishing to speak.
Thank you, Senator. I can't complain. Thank you, Senator. Thank you, committee. It's hard for me to say anything different than what the representative sponsor of the bill told you, so I'm going to try to skip through what I've got here. And one thing I do.
Gold star for you, Representative.
I'm sorry?
Gold star for you.
Gold star? How about a badge?
That would work too.
Just for the record, she did mention that there were many deaths due to overdose last year. There were exactly 321, and it's projected to go to at least 400 this coming year. This bill came to our committee, HHS, in the House. It was passed unanimously, 17-0. The only thing we could do with this bill was to move the effective date up. That was the only thing we could do with it. So I'm very much in support of it. I won't read my statement because it's already been said. And I thank you very much, and I will take questions.
Representative, thank you so much for your testimony. I appreciate it. Senators, any questions for the representative? Seeing none, sir, thank you so very much.
Thank you.
So I do have a question.
Representative LeBron, would you take a question from Senator Fuller Park?
I notice on the House as amended talking about the effective date. It says the effective date is January 2016.
Yes, sir.
Why wouldn't you want to move it up even more?
We probably would have liked to, but we felt safe with January 2016. I would have liked that. Actually, there were two of us who changed the date. I would have liked it to be effective upon passage.
Or 60 days after passage.
Yeah.
Maybe something the Senate can consider.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it. Representative Burt, how are you, sir?
Good. For the record, I'm Representative John Burt. I represent Goffstown, Ware, and Deering, District 39 in Hillsborough. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and fine committee members. Other than it's hotter and blue blazes in here.
It is. Helps us keep the conversation quick.
Well, it does, because I was thinking of joining the Senate, but boy, you guys keeping this warm, I think I may stay in the House. I do support this bill, and let me tell you very quickly why. I thank God every day that I've never done drugs. I don't understand why people would gravitate toward them, but sadly, they do. And this is a real easy solution to help somebody get the care that they need immediately and hopefully to straighten them out. And I just can't imagine a parent losing a child. On Facebook, you know, that's probably not where it should be, but I just saw an obituary of a young lady, I think she's Manchester, 24 years old, and I just said, what a shame. And I could only imagine what her parents go through. Now, I don't know if this particular drug would have helped, but I'm assuming it probably could have. Well, thank you very much.
Representative, thank you for your testimony, sir. I appreciate it. If there's any questions? Seeing none, sir, thank you so very much. Representative Carl Siddell, who's in support and not wishing to speak. Representative Tom Sherman, who is in support and not wishing to speak. I'm assuming Representative Nick Zakari, who is in support and not wishing to speak. Representative Kathy Holzel, in support, wishing to speak. Kathleen, there you are. How are you today?
I'm good, thank you.
Thanks for coming before us today.
For the record, I'm Kathleen Holzel. I'm working in District 3, and I represent Raymond. I'll keep my remarks very brief. I'm a retired nurse, and the mother of six children, none of whom have ever had an issue like this. However, in my career, I saw many issues, and I think I would call it an epidemic, has become tragic. I fully support this because I think it's a way of helping families. I think it's a way of helping those people who are addicted. And I kind of put it the same way as when children have reactions to something and they need an EpiPen. We wouldn't walk away. We would use the EpiPen if they had an allergic reaction. This is very similar. And the cost, I don't care what it costs. If it's going to save someone's life, I think that's very important. So I appreciate you taking my brief testimony.
Representative, thank you so much for your testimony. I appreciate it. Senators, any questions? Seeing none, ma'am, thank you so very much. Representative Elizabeth Edwards, in support, wishing to speak. Representative, how are you? Great to see you again.
Good afternoon. For the record, my name is Elizabeth Edwards. I represent Hillsborough 11, which is in Manchester. I am a co-sponsor on HB 270 and 271. You could say, if you wanted to say that the opioid overdose problem has a silver lining, you could say that there is one, which is that the problem is exacerbated by government policy, and the silver lining side is that it can therefore be mitigated by changing certain government policy. In this case, red tape and criminal justice response to health problems. So, since you support this bill, I would just like to point out that the other half of the solution is the 911 immunity bill, and I encourage you in the strongest possible terms to support that when the whole Senate votes on it. I have quite a bit of data on the organizations who support increased access to Narcan, the American Medical Association, the American Public Health Association, which came out with a great little report, and the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime and the World Health Organization issued a joint report on that recommends increasing access to Narcan. So this is definitely supported by the data. 32 states and DC have passed a bill similar to this one. This bill will not completely solve the problem, obviously, but it will help. And the other half of that is making sure people aren't too afraid to call 911 in the case of an overdose. So please support that as well. I'm happy to take questions, and I have handouts for all you lovely people.
Awesome. Representative Rivers, thank you so much. If you could give handouts to our assistant, I'd appreciate it. And seeing no questions, thank you so much for your testimony.
I would like to point out to Senator Fuller Clark, the last I heard it was $42 for one dose, which is more than it was, but it's still pretty darn cheap to save a life for $42.
I couldn't agree with you more. I'm just concerned that it's being exploited for something that is life-saving.
Mm-hmm. And Representative Bolden and I and the other co-sponsors would certainly support an amendment to make this go into effect sooner. The sooner the better. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We appreciate it. All right. Looks like Representative Emerson in support, wishing to speak. How are you today?
I'm great. Good afternoon, Senators. For the record, my name is Susan Emerson, and I represent Cheshire County District 11. I've turned in my written testimony. Everything that I was going to say has already been said. So in lieu of time, I'd like to just add a couple of things. I hope that this medicine will be available to parents, ambulances, teachers, and friends, because you never know when you're going to come across a overdose. And the Narcan will not hurt anyone if it's accidentally injected into you and I who are not on drugs. And it would be great if you'd put in an amendment to make this passage immediately effective immediately. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. We appreciate it. Seeing no other questions.
Thank you very much.
I missed the Representative John Porthergill, who's also in support, not wishing to speak. And is it Vicki Mercurian from DOS?
Apparently my writing just
did
better.
You're frankly not the worst, and I'm going to be pointing that out in just a second, but yes.
Excellent.
Is it Vic?
It's Nick.
Apparently, for the love of God, seriously. In the state senate, we have this little thing called penmanship. If you can't write it so we can read it, we can always pass yet another law, which I hate to do. So anytime you come, spelling legibly is a wonderful thing, even when you work for the government. Nick, how are you, sir?
Very good, sir. I will work on that so you don't have to take action.
Thank you so much, because you know how I hate passing laws.
Many of the things, well, let me introduce myself first. My name is Nick Mercury. I'm actually the Bureau Chief for Emergency Medical Services. I work for the Department of Safety. The Department of Safety is in favor of House Bill 271. We have seen a significant rise in the amount of Narcan that we have given in Emergency Medical Services over the past just few years here, almost a tripling in the past 3 years. So we are very much in support of this. We're in support of the increasing availability, because as the representative mentioned, it does take time to activate 911 and get emergency medical services to a scene. Depending on where you are within the state, it could be several minutes and potentially a lot more than that. And certainly time is of the essence in this particular situation. So as I mentioned, we're very much in support of it. I really don't have anything additional to add. A lot of it's been said, so.
Nick, I have a couple questions for you.
Sure.
I hear chatter.
Yes.
That making Narcan more available in some cases is having even a more negative effect of having Narcan parties and things like that. Does the Department of Safety have any real-world experience with this? You guys see it, or we're telling the potential problem with it?
No, we're actually not seeing that. And very similarly, this was a very similar discussion when the discussion about passing out clean needles, you know, many, many years ago. And really, that has been something that's been anecdotal and really never been proven that that was a significant cause. Certainly, I don't have a crystal ball, but we are not seeing anything. We wouldn't necessarily anticipate it. May there be some anecdotal information over the years? Potentially. But I think, as the representative, the sponsoring representative had mentioned, there are some many, many positive effects, and I think we have a lot more track record across the country of the positive effects of Narcan as opposed to the negative ones. But we have not heard anything specific at this point.
Thank you, sir. I appreciate it. And the other chatter that we hear when we consider policy like this is essentially how many get out of jail free cards does this maybe provide to people? And I think at some level there's some sort of a policy discussion about if we continue to allow people to continue the process of drug use, knowing that they kind of can use Narcan or some other capacity, or as the representative Edwards said, continue to call 911 without facing any penalty. Where's the Department of Safety weigh in on those types of issues?
I think the Department of Safety is very supportive of basically saving lives, and that's really where we are. People need to be able to get into substance abuse programs to help them through this particular process. We're just a particular spoke in the wheel. And unfortunately, as supportive as we are, the Department of Safety, Emergency Medical Services is very reactionary. However, we need to keep people alive to get them to those other steps. And people do certainly trip going through that process of trying to get themselves clean. So the more that we can get people into substance abuse programs and the more we can keep them alive to do that is really where the Department of Safety is sitting at this particular point in time. I do understand your comment about a get out of jail free card, but this is potentially a long process. The process to get somebody into this particular situation was not a one-time thing. It took a while, so it will take a little while to get them out of it. So this can potentially help them through that continuum.
So we appreciate the department having that attitude.
Just one question.
Senator Abar.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm just curious, do we have any clinics designed specifically for substance abuse in New Hampshire?
We do, but I am not the right person to ask about that.
Thank you.
Seeing no other questions, sir. Whoops, I apologize.
Senator Sandler, do you agree that this is truly a health issue, a crisis?
I don't think epidemic is the wrong word.
Sir, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Truly appreciate it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's start where I stopped. And Doug Griffin in support to speak. And I see Pat Griffin in support, not wishing to speak, but Pat's welcome to come up if you would like, but doesn't have to.
Yeah, that's my wife.
Yes.
I did bring a handout. I thank you for the opportunity to speak.
We apologize. We typically have two chairs.
I'm here today because my daughter is one of those 321 people.
Condolences, sir.
And I also wanted to show you what Narcan is, how it works, and how difficult it is. So that sheet I'm passing out to you is the sheet that's given out in the state of Massachusetts when you're trained with Narcan. And there's a lot of questions about EpiPens and things like that, but this is a very simple procedure. Comes in a carton. There's a nose cone, you see here, that's screwed on top of the aspirator. And then there's these little colored tabs, and you simply remove anything that's colored. That'll allow you to screw this inside here. And then you simply put it into the victim's nose, and you block one side and squeeze. And you have to squeeze a pretty good bit. It's pretty hard to do it. You squeeze half into one side, and then you'd squeeze the other half into the other side. And then you'd wait 3 to 5 minutes. And if they don't come out, then you'd use the second one. It's usually issued in two doses. But I've been working pretty hard with all of these issues since my daughter passed away. And I've been going to meetings in Massachusetts and New Hampshire to try to find out what's different down here than it is up here. And the police departments down there are banding together and buying Narcan in blocks you know, to save money, they watch the prices as they go up and down like it was a stock, and they're buying it when it's the most inexpensive. And I'm sure that if we were to work together as a state, we could find some way to work the cost of those things. And the final thing I have to say is Ross Perot had charts.
Ross Perot had charts.
I have one. That's what you have to lose for simple bill. And I agree it should be the same day it passes. If you have any questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them.
Again, sir and ma'am, our condolences are with you and your family. Senators, any questions? Seeing none, thank you so very much for your time today.
And there is a little card in here also that tells you the, you know, the questions they were saying, what do I do? I mean, you would dial 911 first, blow a rescue breath into the subject, you know, keep them air in their lungs. It's pretty simple. I've been practicing for quite a while. And I get people that call my home, police call my home, parents call my home. And it's awful, you know, because there's nowhere for these kids to go. When they want treatment, they can't get it. It's just not available in the nation. And you might think it'd be easy, well, you know, they're just going to play with this Narcan. Well, let's let them play with the Narcan. Let's let them keep them alive until we can solve the bigger issue of what do we do with them, how do we treat them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Appreciate you coming in today.
Thank you.
Corey McDonald, in support, speaking. Corey, it's been a while. I apologize. Good seeing you again.
Good to see you.
Thank you. Didn't realize you were coming here just representing yourself today.
Sort of, kind of. I'll explain that. So, my name is Corey McDonald. I've been in law enforcement for 18 years. I just took early retirement as deputy chief of the Portsmouth Police Department on March 18th.
Congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. So, I'm now an attorney in private practice, where I've also been sort of in a dual career for the last 10 years. But this morning, prior to coming, I also spoke with Chief Stephen Dubois of the Portsmouth Police to make sure that as I testified in front of the House, that I was able to say that the Portsmouth Police are in support of this bill today. And he has passed that on. So though I'm no longer their official spokesman for this issue, he has given me permission to speak on their behalf. As somebody who was on the front lines of the drug battle for 18 years of my career, I can tell you we support Narcan going out to parents, going out to friends and family members, with the idea that the rumor mill or the talk out there that somehow giving out Narcan is going to make more people want to be addicts it's just baseless. It doesn't make sense. It's like saying if we hand out some insulin, more people are going to sign up to try out diabetes. It's not going to happen. Addiction comes after that first maybe bad decision. But once they're in there, based on my experience, they can't get out without serious treatment and help and oftentimes medicine. What Narcan does is it gives your son or daughter or family member that second chance or third or fourth or fifth chance. And I think if we start to shift that paradigm from it being a law enforcement issue, which is of course tied to crime and punishment and shame and guilt and everything else, and look at it more under that healthcare framework, it stops being a question. Just like we wouldn't say somebody who has bad eating habits and has a heart attack, and then as a subsequent heart attack, we go, well, maybe we should stop treating their heart condition because really they didn't get the lesson the first time. It's a medical issue. And I guess that's what I wanted to impart with you today. Portsmouth Police, support Narcan for friends and family members, and also certainly when it gets to it for law enforcement. How we figure out how to pay for it is another subject, but we're in support, and I'll take any questions.
Corey, I appreciate it. Again, I hadn't heard that you had retired, and of course, you're also a great, great guy.
Thank you.
So, best of luck in your future. But all men and women in blue are great, but you're an outstanding man. So, thank you for all you've done. Senator, any questions? Seeing none, Corey, thank you so much. Next up, Kim Lindsay. Kim, how are you today?
I'm good.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you for having me. My name is Kimberly Lindsay. Say my name. From Dover, New Hampshire, and represent my son, Matthew Scott Dimp. I had never even heard Narcan to my son was addicted to heroin. It was after the night he passed away. And the nurses and the EMTs were telling me about the Narcan. So think going the way it was supposed to.
It's okay, take your time.
I'm just gonna say 18 minutes. 18 minutes from the time that 911 was called, which was called immediately as soon as my son started gasping for air. Everything's been verified by the medical examiners. Well, I want you to know that. And the Somersworth Police Department. It took 11 minutes for the Somersworth Police Department to get to the house that my son was at. They were the first ones on the scene. They did not have Narcan. It took another 7 minutes for the paramedics to arrive at the scene. That's 18 minutes, not to count the few minutes while making the phone call and the first initial panic of his friend that he was with that night. My son, after I talked to several people in the medical profession, that 18 minutes could mean my son is here today. I apologize. My son passed away October 25th of 2012, and I'm still like this every single day. My life. I don't blame anybody, but I think now that this is so in the open, and we know what Narcan can do, and we know Narcan's not going to hurt our children. We need to give them chance after chance after chance to get the recovery they need. My son did not want to die. Two nights before he died, he looked me in the eye and he cried, "I don't want to die. I don't know what to do." We tried the recovery. There is nothing in New Hampshire that can treat opiate addiction. I have did research after research, and there is nothing here. There's no 12-step program. There's no 28-day detoxing that's going to do this. This is intense. Heroin is like no other drug. No other drug. They don't use the heroin because they like it. It's because it controls them. And I know you, Lena, we've got a lot of people to speak. And I could talk forever. I could. My daughter, she's the next to speak, but she wishes not to. She says she can't do it now. But I'd like to tell you, she still cries herself to sleep on a regular basis. Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony. We appreciate
it.
And Mark was out to you and your family.
Thank you.
Hey, Casey, when you ever decide you want to come speak, you always have an open invitation here, okay? Peggy McMillan? Milken? Well, I'm sorry, in support, not wishing to speak. Daryl Perry, in support, not wishing to speak. Bill, it looks like Altman, in support, not wishing to speak. Chris, looks like Rittman. Remember we talked about that whole penmanship thing? We'll get back to that. In support, wishing to speak. Chris, you here?
I am. I have nothing more to add than what's already been said. Thank
Chris,
you.
Chris, thank you very much, sir. I appreciate it. Will Anderson, in support, not wishing to speak. Looks like Donna Marston, in support, not wishing to speak. This is one I can't make out at all. Looks like Ben something from Family Sharing Without Shame.
PETA, not speaking.
In support, not wishing to speak. Looks like, is it Danny or David Herson, in support, wishing to speak?
Good afternoon. How are you?
Good. How are you? Okay. Is it Danielle? Danny? It's a D and looks like an I on the end.
I was going to make a joke about being able to read the physician's name, not the other one, but it's David Hirsch. Sorry.
Seriously?
Yeah.
I love it. Dude, I love you like a brother, but that ain't it. I apologize for crucifying your name.
Thanks for that opportunity. So a lot of what I wanted to talk about has already been covered. I just want to hit on a few important points. So just looking at the scope of the problem, so as you just say, I'm an emergency physician, an EMS physician that works in Concord and the surrounding area. And so I see this problem day in and day out in my normal practice. Just looking at some of the numbers specifically from Concord Hospital, over the past 2 years, our number of opiate overdoses we've seen has doubled. From 2011 to 2014, we went from 7 heroin overdoses in the whole year to 50 just in our ED. So I know that the scope is broader than just here, but just to put some numbers to it. We struggle on a daily basis with resources to give to our patients. It's heartbreaking when people show up with their bags packed saying, I'm here for detox, and we have to turn them away and give them a packet of information, and hopefully they can find some help that way, but we just don't have that kind of resource as an inpatient. A little bit about Narcan or Naloxone. It's been talked about a bit. It's very safe, very effective. The intranasal route is at least 85% effective. Some people will need an additional dose or additional IV dose following that, but a very effective medication. It's also very safe. Most of the side effects stem from, like was talked about, acute withdrawal symptoms, which feel miserable but are not physically dangerous. Things like vomiting, diarrhea, muscle cramps, shivering, but are not physically dangerous to the patient. And I just wanted to add, in addition to that this is obviously an important component of this problem, but it's a multifaceted approach that needs to be undertaken with community resources for treatment, mental health resources, support for law enforcement to help curb illegal narcotics, support for the medical community to help curb the prescription drug abuse that's rampant in the state, and also consideration to activate the EMS system for when this medication is administered for follow-up care and treatment in case there's another medical problem at work. And then support from other community resources for education. So looking toward fire departments, EMS agencies, public health agencies, and medical resources to help roll out education for the use of Narcan would be really helpful. I'm happy to take any questions.
Bob, thanks for your testimony. I truly appreciate it. Senator Kelly?
Thank you. Thank you so much for your testimony. I think everyone here is truly hearing this is a crisis, and I think it's new to the senator sitting here as well. And I certainly support this legislation, and I did sponsor the Good Samaritan 9/11 bill in the Senate, so I think we're all aware that this is such a crisis. And my question to you, and I think you alluded to it, but I just wanted that the Narcan bill, Good Samaritan bill, are good bills to address the crisis, but it's not going to solve the problem. And so I just wanted to hear, I think, from you specifically. You mentioned a few things, but it appears to me that in our state we do not have enough treatment centers to deal with this as a health disease. We are not going to solve this problem through the criminal law. This is going to be solved as a health crisis. And just ask you, why do you think New Hampshire does not have the treatment centers and the prevention, and what can we as senators do to support that?
I guess that'd be a policy question, but I see it from my end. I actually did a search online looking for treatment centers before the session just to see what was around. I was actually surprised that there are several even in Concord, but I think the limitation is access for our patients that need it. And so, you know, whether it's reform so that patients can access those resources without a financial disincentive, which is currently happening, that may be really important. And then I think integration of all the systems together with mental health systems, substance misuse treatments, and then the medical and law enforcement resources to help integrate and coordinate those services would be very important.
Sure. My sense is you see this as a crisis as well.
Absolutely.
And so if we do not invest in some kind of cost, my sense is, or you can respond to this, is how costly will it be if we don't?
Well, I guess, like I was said, it's hard to put a cost on lives. So the data that I have is about $30 to $40 per dose, and it's clearly a life-saving medication. So, you know, the Narcan program is one component, but then the other programs are just vitally important to help support that, getting the patient through the acute event, but then supporting them on the road to recovery is very key.
Thank you.
Okay. Senator Abrams. Senator Kelly had my question. Thank you. Okay.
Doc, so as Senator Folkhart had indicated earlier, we're seeing a pretty big spike in the cost of Narcan, and you know the trademarks have worked out on it. So what's else is available, what's coming, what's prohibiting companies from finding a more cost-effective product?
It's really the only medication that we have of this type, which is frustrating. And we've seen it with other generic medications where even once it's become generic, that doesn't necessarily solve the problem. It's a big part of it, but we've seen that some companies, they don't see the profits anymore, even when they're generic, so they either stop making them or boost the cost. So I don't have a solution for that. You know, there are other similar type medications potentially in the pipeline, but I think we just have to be aware that we're gonna have to pay this cost for now and sort of look for ways to mitigate it in the future. I support you know, communities working together, like was stated, to share the cost and share the burden, working with coordination within fire departments and EMS agencies, hospitals, and maybe even on a statewide basis to help defer the cost and share that.
Thank you, sir. Okay. Appreciate your time.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, Sarah Sadowski from New Futures. How are you today?
Hello, how are you?
You're good, thank you.
Excuse me. A little wider than I remember.
A little wider.
Sorry.
Kate, you back up a little bit.
Sorry, guys. Hello, all, and thank you for your time. For the record, my name is Sarah Sadowski. I'm the Community Engagement Director at New Futures. We work on policy issues related to substance use in our state. I'll be extremely brief. I just wanted to affirm what you've been hearing. We do have a crisis. The lack of treatment that you've heard from families is real. Unless you have deep pockets or a very specific kind of insurance, you're looking at a 6 to 8 week waiting time for residential treatment. And residential treatment isn't the only option, but it is the one that a lot of folks need. So that's a long time to be going through a health crisis. Senator Kelly, you asked a question a moment ago about addressing this as a health crisis. And I just wanted to offer our perspective about why New Hampshire has such an issue. And I think it has a lot to do with the fact that we are second to last in the nation with providing supports for prevention, treatment, and recovery. I think New Hampshire is one of the only New England states that doesn't provide recovery supports for folks in a very affordable way to keep people in early recovery, kind of on target. And so I just wanted to offer that up and ask that you support this bill and recommend it on to pass.
Thank you. Could you take a question from Senator Avar?
Oh, absolutely.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. What are some of the restrictions that you're dealing with? Why we're not getting these centers or in New Hampshire? If there's such an epidemic, which I really believe there is.
Oh, there is.
What are the restrictions from private industries that are coming in here and setting up shop?
For private recovery centers?
Or any kind.
Absolutely. I mean, I can't think of it. I think some of it has to do with uncertainty around funding streams. The New Hampshire Health Protection Act would allow treatment service as substance use benefit for folks under 138% of the federal poverty level. However, that's not certain at the moment. I know that there's been concern from New Hampshire providers of treatment services that what they've provided the benefit that funding might not continue. So I know that there's some hesitation to invest deeper, but I'd have to refer to my colleagues in the Providers Association.
You want to follow up? Sure. So is there any private industry that's looking at it, maybe providing a solution?
You will see interesting private options, some of our religious centers, but that's not enough to stem a public health crisis of this scope, I believe. I do know in Massachusetts there has been a tremendous amount of success with family support groups organizing around naloxone training. That would be pertinent to this bill.
Senator Kelly.
Just to follow up on Senator Avar, it sounds to me like what you're saying is if you don't have health insurance,
even
you would not be able to afford a private center or another rehab.
And I would refer you to some of the families who do have health insurance and find that it doesn't cover what they expect it covers. We do have family members who put people on planes to Arizona, for example, to get there and then are not covered in the same.
That whole network thing is becoming a pretty big issue these days, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. And just to follow up. And your response again to Senator Avard, you're talking about 138% poverty level, which is legislation that we've been able to pass, but at this point,
with the sunset
the budget
provision,
process, not sure
exactly
of what that outcome is going to be.
Right, so that's creating a lot of uncertainty among the public.
Thank you.
Thank you for your testimony.
Thank
we
you very much for your time.
All right, Charles, is it Nuklin?
No.
Okay, I've got Nuklan, but close enough.
Novak. Hi, my name is Charles Novak.
Hey, Charles, thanks for coming in today.
Thank you. I'm the LADAC, the Licensed Alcohol and Drug Counselor.
I've worked for 4 years with Serenity Place, so I've been on the front lines of this problem. I could just repeat everything that everyone said as far as all the organizations in the country that are in support of it. I would just say that I just looked up on Amazon that you can get a single dose for $23. There was one for $14, but it was out of stock. But I could get a set here by Wednesday for $23. I have read some about the cost with the New York police complaining about it. I don't know, they're buying a lot, but everybody who leaves a treatment facility in Mass gets one of these now. They get one. Like, I remember when I left Barnum Center, I got a dime to call somebody. Well, now everybody gets a naloxone kit and is trained how to use it. Family support groups are giving them out. So they're free in Mass. So I don't think costs would be would stop us from running it. And, in my field, I work at the homeless shelter. I volunteer at the day center. And since the summer, I think 1 week has gone by where I don't know somebody who knows somebody who's died. We lost two more people. I've had people who sat next to me in meetings die. I've had dozens of former clients die. I have nothing else really to say.
Thank you for your testimony. Thank you. Is there any questions? Seeing none, thank you so very much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, Greg Pollock in support wishing to speak. Greg, how are you, man?
Good, how are you?
Good, thanks for coming in today.
My name is Greg Pollock, and first I want to apologize for my appearance. I didn't know I was going to be here today.
Hey, Greg, you never need to apologize for your appearance.
All right, so I just wanted to give my personal account. I've been dealing with heroin addiction for the last 3.5 years, and I finally got into treatment about 6 months ago. And I went to a 28-day program, and I was clean for a couple months and had one relapse. And I overdosed and was found in my car, and they administered Narcan, and that's the only thing that saved my life, the only reason I'm here today. And I was parked right around the corner from my parents' house, where I was staying at the time. And I just wonder if I would have made it, if I had made it safely home to the house. And I guess that's all I have.
Appreciate you coming in. You can come anytime, dress any way you want. Remember, we work for you over here.
That's right.
Right? Senator Flocar.
Yes, and where was your treatment?
I went to a private facility in Laconia. I had to go out of state for medical detox and then come back, and my insurance did not cover it. I had to, luckily I had college money saved up. I used that for my treatment.
We hope you stay on the road and recover.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming today. Ladies and gentlemen, I've got Janet Monahan from the Hampshire Medical Society in support not wishing to speak, and Liz Clark for One Voice for Stratford County in support not wishing to speak. So we're still on Senate Bill 271. I don't have anyone else here who was signed up who has not spoken. Is there anyone else who would like to speak before I close the hearing? Sir, come on up. And since I'll write it down, I'll probably be able to read it. What's your name?
My name is Thomas, 2008, T-O-N-S and Nancy, I-O-L-I.
Thanks for coming in today.
Yes, thank you. I initially wasn't going to speak to this issue, and I am in support of everything that has been said today, and I have just one small item to add. I taught high school in New Hampshire for 14 years here before I became ill myself with something else that I'm here to speak about today. But after hearing everyone speak, I just wanted to add one small thing. It's not a small thing, actually. It's just to emphasize how dramatic this issue is in New Hampshire. In speaking with my students a number of years ago, I told them that when I grew up as a teenager, heroin was a drug that was so foreign to me, it was a drug that was confined, in my mind, to inner city ghettos. It was not a drug that was widespread in communities that, to my mind, that we would find in New Hampshire where we lived. And so I asked my students one day, what is it with heroin that it seems to be almost a mainstream drug these days? You hear about it everywhere, that young people from high school students to you know, people in their 20s and 30s use it now on a regular basis, almost like people drink these days. And what's up with that, you guys? Why is heroin almost a mainstream drug these days? And they said to me, Mr. T, it's cheaper than alcohol. People can go out and buy a bag of heroin, and more people can get high on a bag of heroin than they can on a six-pack of alcohol. And I was flabbergasted by that, and the other feelings I had, I won't tell you, but I can see by some of your faces that you're as flabbergasted as I was, or as dismayed as I was by that. It crumbled me to hear that from them, and that, I think, contributes to part of the heroin epidemic, if you will, that we're seeing today. It's so horrible to hear that, and I think that contributes somewhat to what we're seeing in our communities these days, is the cost of heroin has come down so much to people these days, and it's been so it's been so generalized in our community and so accepted by young people these days that they don't even recognize, by many young people, I won't generalize it that much, that they don't recognize the dangers of it, the many dangers of it, that so many people are using it, that I don't know how we could not pass a bill that allows people to have a life-saving drug like this that could save lives no matter what the cost is. And so I would please ask you to
Thank you for the testimony. We appreciate it.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Hey, Doc, can I pull you back up for one more question? So I hear $42. I hear someone's going on Amazon and gets them for 14 and 21. And then I guess my other question was, as a prescriber, are you seeing differences in prices if it's being run through Medicaid, Medicare, or traditional insurance? So what are you seeing? Or are you seeing anything you guys just write scripts and don't know the cost?
Yeah, we're a little disconnected from the cost because we write the prescription. I know a little bit about it based on my EMS work because we give medications to the EMS services to administer in the field. And so we have the benefit of the hospital purchasing power that buys a lot of doses of medications at a time. But it is frustrating when different medications cost different prices for different people at different places you go. And we run into it. One thing that we think about pretty commonly are like antibiotic prices. And we commonly will ask people, you know, do you have medication prescription insurance? And we may actually tailor our therapy based on that. So giving them an equivalent medication that costs $4 versus $300. We do that a lot. So unfortunately with Narcan, like I said, there isn't a readily available alternative, so we're sort of contained by that. But
Doc, thanks so much. I appreciate it. The lady out back first, because she hasn't spoken yet. Ma'am?
Thank you. My name is Cheryl Pacapelli, P-A-C-A-P-E-L-L-I. And I am you're welcome. Glad to be here. I walked in late, so I didn't get my name on the list. So thanks very much for asking if anybody else wanted to share. I am a person in long-term recovery from alcohol and drugs for 25 plus years, and am currently the executive director for Hope for New Hampshire Recovery, which is an organization that is trying to provide recovery support services here in New Hampshire. New Hampshire is the only state in New England that doesn't have a recovery community center model. We're trying to build a network of those. Funding is the issue for that right now. But I worked in Connecticut for Connecticut Community for Addiction Recovery for 9 years, running their three recovery community centers and we saw 15,000 visitors a year at each center. Those are duplicated numbers. People come in every single day, and the outcomes that we had for support were unbelievable to reduce people's use, reduce if people did relapse, that the level of care they needed was not ER, like we heard talked about. So I know this is the Narcan bill, but we have a piece in this where we can help while people are waiting to get into treatment and things like that. And you know, I personally, in my own personal life, know people that were administered Narcan 10 times before they got into recovery and are now years into recovery. So, you know, it's just really important that we not look at how many times it takes. You know, we don't question a diabetic that keeps eating donuts. We keep helping them. We keep giving them food classes, and we keep letting them come into the ER and showing them how to use the insulin. And I think, you know, you talked about it. This is a health crisis. We are not going to arrest our way out of it or anything. So I just needed to, like, let you guys know people do recover. There's 23 million people in long-term recovery, and I'm one of them, and I'm proud of it. So.
Cheryl, we're proud of you, too. Thanks so much for coming in and chatting with us today. Senator Fuller Park.
Yeah. Just to echo that, we are proud of you and proud of everybody who's doing their best struggling with this issue. What could we learn from Connecticut in terms of turning New Hampshire around?
Well, so I think it's not only Connecticut, but we can learn from Vermont and Rhode Island, too. In Vermont, they have 13 recovery community centers currently. And I don't know the numbers of how many people they see, but they have reduced costs significantly by providing recovery coaching to people that come in. In Rhode Island, they saw 112 people in 9 months, and 81% asked for services. So if you present in the ER, in five different ERs in Rhode Island, they offer you a recovery coach as soon as you get in there. And within a half an hour, someone comes, a peer, talk to them, and 81% of those people said, yes, I want services. So, and in Rhode Island, though, they can tell them, come to the Recovery Community Center tomorrow. We can sign you up for telephone recovery support. We can assign you a recovery coach. We can get you into a recovery house. New Hampshire has a lot of work to do to build that continuum of care, but I think that we need to start building it, because people, like, I've been in recovery 25 years. I've never seen so many people die. I mean, never have. So it's really, we are in a...
Follow up, please.
So how are those community recovery centers paid for? How do they support it?
In Connecticut, it's 100% paid for by the state. That's Connecticut. In Vermont, the state pays a certain amount to each recovery community center, and they're all independent 501c3s. In Rhode Island, they were funded through a federal grant, Recovery Community Services Program grant, to get started. That grant has run out, and they are part of the Providence Center, which is a treatment program, and they have a fiduciary relationship with them. And I'd be happy to talk to any of you outside of this about what this looks like and Hope's business plan and things like that, so I don't take up the time here. I'm happy to sit here and answer all your questions.
Appreciate it, but at this point, we're already an hour behind.
Yes, that's what I thought. So I'll leave my card over there, and anybody that wants to talk to me.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Hey, Greg, you have something else to add?
Go ahead.
I just wanted to touch on one more issue really quickly. It came up, there was a worry about the distribution of Narcan increasing use. And I just want to say, when I was first getting involved with heroin, I guess I was naive. I didn't realize how easy it was to overdose. So that was very far from my thoughts. And then when I was in the throes of my addiction, it didn't matter if there was Narcan there or not. I was going to keep using. That's all I have to say.
Yeah, awesome. Greg, thanks so much. I appreciate it. All right, ladies and gentlemen, House Bill 271. Anyone else like to speak before I close the hearing?
Can I ask a question?
You can,
Representative. I don't know if that's out of line. I'm I'm pretty sure I know how a bill becomes a law, but I could have missed something, because I could have sworn that when this passed the House unanimously, that the Health and Human Services Committee over there amended the bill to make it effective immediately upon passage. But when I look at the bill online, I see that
that's one of the things we'll look into as we're doing our research, because right now it says the bill is January of 2016. But we have the ability in the Senate to amend bills, as you know, so I'm sure it's something we'll be discussing. Awesome. Thank you so much, Amanda. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll close the hearing on House Bill 271. Thank you all for coming in today. No, we're in Hollywood.